What's up, sweaties? I am Robert Meyer Burnett, and I'm here to host Heroes, episode 92. I'm filling in here for John Schnepp, and I'm very excited. It's my first time hosting, well, anything on the internet. And I've got two of the birds of prey here with me. First of all, I have Amy Dallen. How are you, Amy?
Hello, I am good, and like just seven times as good as I was a moment ago, because that's fantastic.
Wow, which
and then bird of course, prey are you?
Ooh, I usually dibs on Oracle. I don't know.
You can be Oracle.
Is that okay?
That's totally okay.
And then we've got Ashley V. Robinson.
Hello, because I'll just call dibs on the Cassandra Cain Batgirl,
yeah,
who was Birds of Prey in the 90s and early aughts. So it'll work out okay.
Yeah, we're a flashback lineup, Birds of Prey.
Exactly.
Well, I think it's really exciting. You know, we had Mark Andreyko here, and I didn't get to congratulate you because I haven't seen you since Love is Love came out, but you have a story in that.
I do, with Jason Inman, Taylor Esposito, and Nick Robles. We are a page called The Swan Story. We're right beside Liam Sharp, so all Wonder Woman fan all the time.
How cool is that to have like a prestige comic of your own that you can like give to people and be proud of it? Is that great?
It's amazing. The most amazing thing is that people keep thanking us for it. So I feel like it's better than doing a real comic or like a standalone comic on your own, because it is going towards helping the victims of the Pulse nightclub shooting. It's going to such a good cause. So it's really amazing, actually.
You guys, like all the contributors, volunteered your time
we
for
did.
This anthology, which is currently sold out everywhere, but they're planning on a new printing. So put your names down on lists, pre-order it on Amazon, whatever you're going to do. It's temporarily unavailable, but they are trying to make more.
Or you can get digitally on Comixology.
Yeah.
And they just apprehended that dude's wife.
Yeah, I saw that
yeah,
the other
so
day.
So I was thinking, is that marketing for you guys?
I'm just going to say that it was because of us.
I know, it's terrible.
Yeah, justice.
Well,
yeah.
Listen, we should. We don't have her because she's not part of the Birds of Prey, but Wonder Woman. Wonder Woman has announced, or sort of has announced, the main villain. This new nugget dropped in a French publication, translated, it states, behind these scientific formulas, there is a deadly gas that could well annihilate humanity. Well, now it turns out that this is precisely the goal of Ares, the god of war. He is jealous of humanity, which is a creation of his father, the deceased Zeus. He was killed by Ares when he rebelled against him, with the help of the Amazons. With Ares confirmed and Circe rumored, it looks like this will truly be a war of the gods. How does that sound to you, Ashley?
I think that sounds amazing. If you are a Wonder Woman fan, if you've done a lot of reading, or if you haven't, you can ask Amy to recommend you some stories. Ares is like a big staple of Wonder Woman's canon in the DC animated Wonder Woman standalone movie with Kerry Russell and Nathan Fillion.
Which is great.
Yes, and I think Rosario Dawson is also in that before she was on a Marvel show. Ares is the villain of that, so I think it's a very logical step to make him the villain, and we know that they're kind of teasing the Greek god origin from the New 52, so that might bring some interesting power dynamics, I think, to the movie.
Now, what do you think? I was a huge fan of Perez's Wonder Woman run in the 80s.
Often started considered the 80s. Like sort of the classic
mm-hmm.
run.
Yeah, post-crisis. Mm-hmm. Did you read that? What do you think of this
I've read
news?
Chunks of that. I haven't actually sat down with the whole thing yet. But it is the one that we all think of when you're like the classic Wonder Woman run. Like you're either picturing Jose Luis Garcia Lopez or you're picturing George Perez. I love this choice for the movie because it makes it clear that the thing we all hoped they were doing with the World War I setting is what they're doing.
Mm-hmm.
So obviously the real Wonder Woman came around in World War II. But they've chosen World War I, maybe to distinguish it from Captain America, maybe just because it ties in so perfectly with their theme, which, and you can find this in the Golden Age Wonder Woman comics. She emerges basically because she's going to war with the concept of war and strife. Despite being a warrior born and raised, she emerges into the wider world, man's world, and sees what people are doing to each other and is horrified. And as a historical example, World War I is a perfect time for that because it was when we developed really deadly weapons. Mm-hmm. And it's when we developed notably some of the first bioweapons. The nerve gas experiences from World War I are terrible. Like, landmark moments and bad things in history. And so what I loved about this information was that, like, we'd seen that sort of deadly gas thing in some of the previews, but it really confirms that it ties the idea of those particularly destructive and cruel weapons of war with her main fight.
Mm-hmm.
And that's, I think, what we all hoped was happening as soon as they said World War I. So, yeah.
Well, like you
I'm
said,
excited.
There was planes, there was armor in that war. They called it the war to end all wars. I mean, I think it's really interesting, again, the idea of putting superheroes in these real-world situations. It worked really well with Captain America, the First Avenger.
Mm-hmm.
But I love the World War I setting. So you don't have, there's no super science then. You know, Ares, the fact that he's going to be manipulating behind the scenes or whatever, he's bringing the idea of warfare to the next level, which I think if... Although I don't... How do you guys feel about if Ares is responsible for World War I? Does that sort of absolve humanity?
Not any more than him being involved in World War II does in the comics. Like, he can be rooting for our worst impulses. He can be enabling them, but, like, you have to go along with it for that to happen. Like...
Yeah, it's just like the argument that people make with people who are Nazis or who worked with the Nazi party. Like, I was just doing my job is not a good enough excuse. And I hope that they don't use that as a way to absolve some of the bad guy human characters that we're going to see here. And I don't think they're going to do that because we haven't seen that in other comic book movies. And I don't think that this particular DC universe would lean that way. Plus, it's just more guys for Wonder Woman to punch in the face. And that's what we're all here for.
Yeah.
Well, I just want to see, like...
And or stab with hidden swords that she's
in her dress.
Yes!
Do you think that we're going to see, like, some mystical, maybe on the top of Mount Olympus, battle between Ares and Wonder Woman? I mean, at the end of the film...
A la Balrog and Gandalf?
I mean, something like, which I would love to see that. I would love to see that, you know, if Wonder Woman have the sort of the, you shall not pass, you shall not go back to the world of men. I don't know.
I hope so. I would definitely be down for that. I think if you're going to lean into that, why not take it all the way? And being able to, like, visually elevate them above man's struggle also helps to divorce the two kinds of stories that you're trying to tell that Amy was talking about earlier.
Although, if you like, if you take that big battle and place it, like, not necessarily in the middle of people, because that would create some public relations problems.
Right.
But, like, but very close to, like, the closer she is to the people she's trying to protect or get him away from, like, the more stakes there are for Wonder Woman. Mm-hmm. So that would be one argument for putting that in, like, the battlefields or just adjacent to a battlefield.
Just put him on the top of Big Ben.
Yes.
Well, on the other side of the pond, on the other side of the universes, we go to Black Panther. Apparently, Black Panther is going 1990s. I don't know if that means young Black Panther was a grunge rocker or not. Soundgarden, Nirvana, or Pearl Jam, I don't know.
As the meme is going around, what are the 10 albums that influenced T'Challa as a teenager?
Secret Garden, Backstreet Boys.
Well, as Ryan Coogler and his team begin production on next year's Black Panther film, we recently learned of a flashback sequence involving young T'Challa in St. Mary's College, and he'll be riding the Oakland Transit bus. The entire Black Panther team is set up in Atlanta now for the shoot, but they have been getting some exterior shot over in Oakland, California. Will this sequence give a bigger backstory to his relationship with Killmonger, played by Michael B. Jordan? What do you think, Ashley?
I think as a child of the 90s, it's really weird that we're reaching back to a time that I remember from nostalgia. It feels like this is, you know, we did the 80s for a long time, and now that Stranger Things has kind of peaked that, we're like moving right along into the 90s. It feels like a good wheelhouse for Ryan Coogler to work within. And a lot of the visuals and the music elements that he's pulled from in his other movies, which you could maybe highlight here. I also love the idea that we're playing with the idea of T'Challa as an immigrant, even if it's just an immigrant student, because we do know he goes back to Wakanda and he's king and he's the most amazing Black Panther. But that's something that I think would be really important to address now. And yeah, the 90s has some great music.
Well, with the Black Panther hot toys shipping, how do you feel about this news? I mean, I'm very excited about Black Panther.
Do you have pre-order?
I do. I don't know if I can afford it, but I do have it.
You have X amount of time to make that work.
Absolutely. What do you think about this news?
Well, as a lot of people pointed out as soon as this came out, like, just it's a, I assume, a minor piece of the film. But the big question is this something that just informs a future relationship, or is this going to be an experience that shapes how he feels about, say, America?
Yeah.
If he's going to end up coming back here and dealing with things, you must assume that a formative experience in Oakland in the 90s, not that they were the 1940s, but, like, you know, one has to ask, will this be a good experience or a bad one?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, I'm curious to see. I never really thought of that he lived in Oakland. I mean, is that part of the comic mythology?
Usually, as American stuff, he's dabbled in New York.
Yeah,
that's what I thought.
Most people don't make it over to the West Coast unless they're on the West Coast Avengers.
I mean, is there going to be.
Hanging out with Wonder Man? Black Panther, Wonder Man, make it happen.
Oh,
well, yeah, I mean, can you imagine the hip hop battle's going to go on in this movie? I mean,
that would be amazing. I would love that.
Or he could be like, this music is, I don't get it. And they would be like, ugh.
But that would be so funny.
And then there's a cut forward 2 years where he's like totally enculturated.
It'd be a great sort of answer to what we did in Luke Cage, even though I know that the cinematic and the TV universes are not necessarily the same, but because that is so entrenched in, like, East Coast and rap, like contemporary rap and hip-hop culture, to have this other character on the opposite coast be alienated by that kind of music, that would be, I think, a really interesting comparison between the two series.
Yeah, I'm actually looking forward to that, because the idea that every episode of Luke Cage was from the title of a Gangstar song. I mean, maybe we'll get a little Eric B. and Rakim in this, maybe a little Wu-Tang Clan, you know, who knows? Or some Too Short.
Nice.
I love Too Short. Does anyone listen to Too Short anymore?
When's the Too Short Hot Toys coming?
Oh, that I would like Hot Toys of all of my favorite hip-hop artists, beginning with the Sugar Hill Gang.
I'm surprised that's not a thing. Is that a thing?
Well, there's a company
called Hot Toys can let us know anytime, and we'll be happy to help them.
Well, okay, on that tip, let's not talk about rap music on this show. We can, but we shouldn't, because we should move on to the Defenders, and who knows what music they're going
to
be listening
to. Back to New York.
The Defenders are coming. This week, Entertainment Weekly put a bright spotlight on the upcoming 8-part Netflix series, The Defenders, and how excited are we, which highlights the coming together of Hell's Kitchen's 4 badasses, Daredevil, Jessica Jones, Luke Cage, and the newest member of the group, Danny Rann, a.k.a. Iron Fist. We've got Sigourney Weaver playing the big bad, and it seems like the best bet is we will see the return of the Hand, as well as Elektra. Jeff Loeb stated, I think the other part that separates us from, let's say, our distinguished competition, is that we take place in a very real, grounded world. We've always said that there is a fifth defender, and that is New York. What are your expectations for Iron Fist and then the Defenders? Amy, what do you think?
I'm really excited. Iron Fist, I know very little of how that one's going to go. I know I'm looking forward to it, but yeah. I know I'm like ready to line up for Defenders right now. Just because it's been so much fun to watch the like a sort of astonishingly successful transition of these characters to the screen.
I think that's an accurate adjective.
Yeah. And so in that sense, like, they benefited, each individual show benefited a lot from being standalone, mm-hmm. but it feels as if now this is kind of our reward for investing that time, is now they get to go full comic book and all hang out, and Sigourney Weaver will be there. So I'm friggin' psyched.
And do you share this optimistic appraisal of the situation?
I definitely do. I think it's hard to not be enthused for this because all of the Netflix series that have preceded this, obviously we haven't seen Iron Fist yet, have been so exceptional. I do want to take two pieces of umbrage with the piece of art that they've shown. Why is Luke Cage not the one who's topless? Why is it Danny Rand? And I just want to point out that, again, only the female character is the one in a sexualized pose. And Jessica Jones is a character in a series that really railed against this. So I think that's kind of a bummer that she couldn't be in, like, a hero pose.
I'm going to back Ashley up on that. I think a lot of women just independently happened to notice that this was a really interesting choice. I get that she's painting on the thing and that she is a beautiful lady, but I might have made a different choice if I were in charge.
And the comments section just exploded. Hey there. I even know who's going to say what in the comments section, I think. No, but I am very excited. What I love about this picture, actually, is the color palette. Yeah. One of the great things about these Marvel shows is I love the way they look. And there's this great sort of heightened sense of reality, even though it is on the mean streets of New York. There's a colorfulness to them that isn't garish, but there's something like, it's almost like modern noir. The kind of, the way Miami Vice was in the 80s, the Marvel shows for Netflix have a very modern noir feel to me, where they use color instead of black and white, if that makes any sense at all.
It does.
I'm really, really excited for this stuff. Now, what do you think about only 8 episodes? Would you have liked 13?
That's tough. I think... Sure, I would have wanted 13. Yeah. I would have wanted 20 of all the preceding series. But I think 8 is a really safe bet. It was just like with the first Avengers movie. We didn't have anyone signed on for any more team-up movies because we don't know how this is going to go. It's really untested water. And obviously, they feel like the story that they have is going to be best served in smaller doses. And if everyone loves it, and if we break Netflix, we'll get more.
Right, I'm really excited. I mean, and we know we're going to get Jessica Jones season 2. I think we're getting the Iron Fist season first.
And then Defenders
and then Jessica Jones season 2.
Yes.
Now, did you guys like Jessica Jones?
I like Jessica Jones. I don't like it. I like it the least of the 3 I've seen so far.
How come?
If I was going to rank them. I took some umbrage with some of the ways that things were adapted and with some of the ways that there were lines that I felt like were meant to empower women, but they weren't executed in maybe the best way possible. Mm. And I think they spent a lot of time with David Tennant because he's a beloved actor. Like, we love him as the 10th Doctor. Really trying to play down, like, what a creep he was until they had to go really hard at the end. And I think that's a disservice to both Jessica and the Purple Man.
Mm. What about you?
I loved it. There were moments in it that I was like, I'm not sure this line is landing for me, or I'm not sure about this execution, but it's hard. I can't be objective about it because the show did things I've never seen anyone do in a show. In terms of, like, I think that that perspective, this is going to go to kind of a serious place, y'all, but I have never seen stories about things like sexual assault presented without any, we're going to make it sexy and titillating.
Yeah.
And that sounds like a small thing, but it's not a small thing.
And the criticism is splitting hairs on
totally valid.
Great products.
Totally valid. Yeah. That was just one of those approaches. Like, and you know, y'all know I'm a little bit of a squeamish type. So there were some moments in Jessica Jones where I was like, I'm not sure this is strictly necessary. But it was incredibly effective storytelling for me, and I'm very excited because it was a view on the world, a perspective, a set of priorities that I hadn't seen in other places, and I love it. So no, even though it was massively different from the comic, which I adore.
Yeah.
I agree with you. I mean, I thought there was a maturity level. They did go into some dark places. And I thought, you know, the showrunner is a woman.
Yes.
And I thought that
Melissa
Rosenberg?
Yeah. She brought, I think, a level of sophistication that I was not expecting, especially from a comic book-based show. And I think it's actually a very important show as far as the evolution of television is concerned.
I agree. And I love that in the second season, they are going for all female directors as well. I think that's really powerful, especially because I love Brian Michael Bendis, but this is a character who's meant to represent a certain swath of the female population that was created by a man. So by giving it over to adaptation by female voices, I think is a really important move.
But I do love that the comic is also still going on, has come back, rather, with the original co-creators, Michael Gatos and, am I getting this right, Michael Gatos and Brian Michael Bendis, with David Mack on covers. So the original dream team for the comics is back in place, and we just get to have our cake and eat it, too. It's amazing.
Well, speaking of other teams from the Marvel Universe, let's talk about X-Men movies and television. Are they connected? What is going on? It's, as John would say, it's crazy. There's so much mutant flavor on TV, I don't even know what to say about it. With both Legion and a new X-Men family on the run from Sentinel series coming up on the small screen, and Deadpool 2, the New Mutants, and possibly another X-Men feature film in production, will these be set in the same universe? While speaking with IGN, producer Lauren Shuler-Donner recently stated, the cinematic universe will not worry about Legion. They will not worry about these TV worlds at all. They will just continue in a way that they have been continuing, that there is some great stuff and we are developing. I can just say it's going to be new and different. And yet Legion and our other shows were not going to get in each other's way. So no high-profile X-Men cameos? It depends, she says. The feature side comes first, unfortunately, because it's established. They're our characters, so they can come first. And as we decide the feature world and where we're going, there are certain characters that we know we won't get into, or if we do get into, it's okay to have them have an appearance.
New, different, and edgy are my three favorite buzzwords.
I know, right? Now, is it a good idea?
New and different for X-Men has a special, like, oh, good job.
It does, for sure.
Sorry.
Oh, my goodness.
Oh, no.
Got an announcement to make. Yes, we
Oh, Canada?
We got an announcement to make for all of the heroes of yours. Which camera's ours? That one's ours.
That's ours.
So, you notice that John Schnepp's not here. He's out doing his spiritual walkabout in the backwoods of the Yukon.
With Alpha Flight.
With Alpha Flight, as it turns out. Getting in one with his Sasquatch nature. So... he's out for a little while. He'll be back. Don't worry. He'll be back soon. But you've got a match coming up in the Movie Trivia Schmodown this week.
I do, with that little pipsqueet Hector Navarro and his friend.
And his friend
Adam.
And friend.
So, but your partner is John Schnepp.
Yes.
So he's not available. So coming up this Friday. On the Movie Trivia Schmodown, part of the doubleheader, two matches dropping on the same day. Of course, we've got the Beast Bibiani versus JTE, but now the second match is going to be Team Superhero News with Adam and the little engine that choked, Hector Navarro, versus Robert Meyer Burnett and myself.
This is very exciting, very exciting.
All I can say is, hug your loved ones, close out any unsettled business you have, and then show up on Friday for your spanking kids. So we'll see you then.
Doesn't Hector, play board games on the internet, live? Does he do
yes.
that?
Yes.
Yeah, he does, doesn't
and?
He?
And?
Just saying, he plays board games on the internet. That's like watching someone else play video games.
We all watch other people play video games.
Well, I'm just saying, look, you know what? If you want to take Hector's side, that's fine.
I'm just saying!
Hector's going to get stomped on. I know this isn't the place for it because it's heroes, but Navarro is going down.
I don't even know how we're supposed to move on from this.
Actually, wait a minute. Let's talk about the X-Men worlds.
Needless fighting. We're back to X-Men.
All right, let's talk about love and accepting.
Let's back to heroes. Okay, do you think all of these X-Men universes should be connected? Is it going to be? I mean, I don't think that the continuity in the X-Men films has exactly been, you know, ironclad.
To say the least. I think the X-Men movies, like, need to go to bed for maybe 5 years after Logan, because I'm really excited for Logan, and then maybe we should readdress that, because it's a little muddied. I think it's interesting that we're seeing the X-Men franchise take a note from, like, Marvel Entertainment proper, because they keep their, again, their TV and their cinematic continuity separate. But I think that if there's one thing you can learn from the X-Men comics, it's the more divided you are and the more teams you have from different time, the more diluted it gets, and that tying them together, even tangentially, and it doesn't have to be a cameo, it can be like the Avengers references where it's like, oh, that thing that happened in New York, I think that would be really important, especially to bringing more of the movie audience over into things like Legion, because it's going to be a tougher sell than just making the Phoenix Saga, which we're all expecting any second now.
Now, what about you? What do you think? Well, Amy, can they do it?
Keeping them separate makes sense for where we are right now. Mm-hmm. I won't be happy unless there are some, like, labels on things or brand names or references that tie these into some kind of common X-Men mythology, mm-hmm. To say the least. But it's hard to say, like, they should be coordinating, because I'm not 100% sure coordinating with what.
That's a fair point.
and I love, like, if you were doing everything from the ground up, I would love a total coordination of movies and TV, but everything has started at different times and is in different places. So I think letting everybody do their own thing and seeing which ones people really respond to, mm-hmm. It sounds like Lauren Shuler Donner was really leaving the door open there, where she's like, they're not going to show up. I mean, they might. Let's see how it goes.
Yeah. You
know? I think certainly Legion, the filmmakers behind Legion, have made a strong sort of case that they want to be kind of a self-contained, doing their own thing. The other show with the family on the run seems like the one where you'd really have a lot of possibilities for tie-ins or appearances from movie folk, but that's going to depend on all these unanswered questions we have about New Mutants and how that ties into the set of X-Men we just met, or whether they're going to be recast, or like where they are in the timeline. And at the moment, it sounds like we have to answer all those questions at once.
It's also tough to be the face of a company or the representative of like a giant organization like this and be trying to answer a question that could change in the next 25 years.
Yeah.
So I think she's like trying her best to be like, we're going to do whatever we're going to do, so just let us do what we're gonna do.
Yeah.
And we like the X-Men, so we're all here for it no matter what happens.
Well, I think what's interesting is, you know, they've set this precedent with the films, with the Marvel Cinematic Universe, that we don't love anything more than seeing characters get together and have it be great.
Nerds love continuity.
I mean, even, you know.
But it can work when you don't, like, we're going to have two Flashes and that's going to be fine.
That's true.
Are these X-Men movies more on that model? Mm. Like, where it's just like, maybe there'll be an Xavier on TV that we meet briefly and he's just not the Xavier from the movies, but we all deal with it. Maybe.
But will he also be English, even though he's from New York?
Now, do you guys have a character, like, if you could have your dream X-Men character, only one now, who would it be? That we haven't seen yet. You can't say that, I want to see a different Storm, or I want to see... If there's an X-Men character we have yet to see portrayed in any X-book.
I would like a return of Nightcrawler, because Nightcrawler is my favorite character, and I think you just pay Alan Cumming whatever he wants to get back in the blue makeup. Or I've always said that I would love to see a live-action Dupe, because it's just so out there, and he's such a great character.
What if Nightcrawler was the mentor to the on-the-run kid in the, like, family hiding
and it's
him
Dupe?
Thing?
I would love that.
No one should be behind me on this but Husk. We have the technology. Make it happen.
Wow, that's an interesting
choice. They're doing New
Mutants,
and I'm a Generation X kid. I'm not proud of it. But that book was amazing.
So. Own it.
It was amazing until it sucked, and then I still loved it.
See, I can't wait to see Warlock. Like, I don't know how they're going to do that.
I'm not surprised by that choice.
Yeah, I mean, it's not one of my favorite, necessarily, X-Men. I mean, I was really partial to the New Mutants, the mm-hmm. original lineup of New Mutants. I loved, like, Moonstar. I love Sam Guthrie.
But those are all characters that are not so entrenched, even in current comics continuity.
Right.
So, like, it'd be great to have them on screen.
I mean, that whole Asgardian War storyline, when Arthur Adams came and did that special, you know, that was the greatest
comic
ever.
What are the rules there? Can Danny Moonstar become a Valkyrie?
There's no rules.
Regular Marvel owns Thor.
Well, but Norse mythology is public domain.
Okay.
As long as it's not.
Oh, no. You know what? We can't go down this road. You know what road we can go down? We can go down the road of minor mutations. Yes.
You're killing it, Robert.
And here we go. Number one, the Inhumans are shooting in both Chicago and Los Angeles. That's exciting. And Peter Dinklage is in Infinity War. Yay. Will he play Pip the Troll? Or will he play MODOK? I don't know. X-Men Underground Railroad pilot gets ready to shoot for Fox. Rhett, Reese, and Paul Wernick say Deadpool will shoot this year. That would be Deadpool 2. Will shoot this year with Colossus and Negasonic Teenage Warhead returning. Batfleck is so tired of being asked, what's up with the Batman? He doesn't want to answer the question anymore. And the final Logan trailer is expected later this week after being teased on social media by both James Mangold and Hugh Jackman. What pops out to you, Ashley?
There's a lot of X-Men stories is what pops out to me. I want to talk about the Batfleck thing because I feel like Ben Affleck gets brought up a lot with the way that he behaves in interviews or his answers. I've interviewed him and I thought he was completely lovely. And I will say that when you're asked the same question 1,000 times and you legit can't give an answer, sometimes that's really tough. And it's like we were saying just a bit ago about the people who are representing X-Men. It's hard to give an answer when you're not allowed to or you don't have one. So I'd be like, give the guy a break. The Batman movie is coming. So don't worry too much about it. I think it's interesting how many different X-Men, I didn't even realize it until you listed all these stories off, but how many X-Men or Inhumans are basically the X-Men now. things are like in active development. That's crazy. And I'll be interested to see with the Inhumans if they're going to shoot L.A. for Chicago or Chicago for L.A.
Which
or both of those for Adelaide. Like, if we're doing exteriors, those are vastly different aesthetics that you're working with. So, I don't know.
And are the Inhumans going to cross over with Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.?
That seems like they have to.
You would think.
They've spent a lot of time working on the Inhuman side of the mythology in Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. So I would hope that they are planning to coordinate.
Or if nothing else, is Daisy going to show up in Inhumans?
Right. That would work.
Now, what pops out to you of our minor mutations?
The same sort of, much as I desperately want to know what's going to happen with the Batman movie, I'm also in the kind of, Ben Affleck is a human being and this must be really frustrating camp. There is a level of, obviously he shouldn't be surprised people are asking about Batman because it's Batman, but he's probably not surprised. He probably just, that must get really old. You made a different movie, and everybody wants to talk about Batman.
Right, on the red carpet for Live by Night.
Yeah. On the other hand, can't wait for there to be real answers and everyone to be in the doing phase rather than the getting asked about phase.
Development sucks for us. It sucks to be like, oh, well, there's some stuff written on some paper somewhere.
And then that thing of, we might not want to know because we'll just, they need space to change their minds a bunch of times and find something that works. Mm-hmm. If they end up committed to something before they've thought through whether it's going to work, we'll end up with a movie we don't want.
Yeah.
So in that sense, I know, maybe not to say it on this show, but, I don't want to know until you're ready to tell me.
Mm-hmm.
I want to know when your movie is ready. I get excited about every detail that drops, but I want to make sure you're making the movie you want to make.
Mm-hmm.
So, don't rush into it.
Now, I've got a question for you both. The final Logan trailer, we had Johnny Cash doing a cover in the first trailer, a little Trent Reznor. Do you think that the final Logan trailer is going to have a song, a cover version, and if so, what song would that be?
I think if they're smart, they won't put, if it was me, I wouldn't put any music over it. Because Hurt makes everything sound cool. You can literally play any trailer over that without the audio, and it's going to sound more amazing and more dramatic because that song is so great. And divorcing sound from a storytelling device like a trailer is a really bold move. So just let the merits of your movie shine through. If it were me, I would set it over something like super sad white guy music, like Morrissey maybe.
Sheila take a bow.
Yeah, it'd be great.
Wow, that's Morrissey. That's okay. What about you? Any thoughts on that?
I guess I would just probably pick something that evokes the Western setting in an orchestral way. But it would be
something from Westworld from the piano.
but it would be interesting to get another sort of singer-songwritery take in there. They would never do this, but pick a really bleak Tori Amos song.
Nice.
And just make everybody lonely and afraid.
But do it from her perspective, X-23's perspective, because we have the female singer.
Oh, now that's a real, I like that. That's a really, really good idea. Well, and you, in the comments section, what song do you guys think, if there's going to be a song at all?
Robert, do you have an answer for that one?
I don't.
Oh.
You know what? I would cut every trailer I could to New Order's Blue Monday, the original dance mix, not the Quincy Jones remix from 87, but the original. 81
and the comments roll in.
I know. And you know what that takes us to? That takes us to the Twitter questions. Twitter questions. Tyrion Lannister asks, do you think a more serious future version of Deadpool could appear in the Logan movie? Ashley, do you think that can happen?
No. I think if we're getting a Deadpool cameo, it's going to be exactly the same one that we've had in the previous Deadpool movie. And I think since we had such success with that, why would you do a more serious version?
It sounds like what they're driving at, maybe the sort of the like, there's been a couple of times in recent comics where you sort of find an extremely aged and slightly more bitter or deranged Deadpool in the future. And that sounds like what they were sort of might be hinting at when they say more serious. And there was a time where I was like, that makes a certain amount of sense to me. This is a future thing. Deadpool has immortality. They've used this trick before. And I like it when they use it well, but it just doesn't seem like it would fit in any version with the movie that it looks like we're getting. Mm-hmm. So I would say most likely not.
See, I don't know why, but I have some sneaking suspicion. Deadpool made $750 million worldwide. And there's Ryan Reynolds had such an attachment to Hugh Jackman. This is going to be perhaps the last movie, unless I can convince him. I would love to see, like you just said, a just embittered, not funny, you know, Deadpool somewhere. Like
as played by Ryan Reynolds?
Played by Ryan Reynolds. He's maybe in age makeup. I mean, he's messed up anyway. And he's just really sardonic and blackly just bitter, just burnt out and finished. Even for one scene. Mm-hmm. I think they could do it. I don't know. Maybe. Maybe not. I'd love to see it. But anyway, Matt Yamasaki asks, when does the clock run out for Fox to get a Fantastic Four movie into production before the rights relapse back to Marvel? Actually, relapse? Will they relapse the rights? I think Fantastic Four have relapsed three times already.
Well, the straight-up answer to that is it depends on the terms of their contract. Because there's not a statute of limitations on that the way there is on whether or not characters are going to go into the public domain. I would assume it's got to be like, what's the longest period we have between FF movies? 7 years, 8 years?
I have no
idea. I mean, it's only been a year since.
I mean, between Fantastic Four 2, so between Rise of the Silver Surfer and Fan4stic, like that's probably the max. Yeah. So I don't know, probably a lot longer than we would like, unfortunately. But again, it depends on the terms of the contract.
Yeah, it's also kind of a strange thing in the sense that, you know, when the Fantastic Four movies started coming out, there was no Marvel Cinematic Universe yet.
That's right.
And now everybody's like, oh, give it back to Marvel, give it back to Marvel. And now there's this weird pressure that didn't exist when the X-Men contract was first signed or the Fantastic Four contract was first signed. What do you think?
Oh, I just don't know the details. I know that
we don't work.
Yeah, I know. Like we have all the contracts right here. Let me just pick out that Fantastic Four contract.
I wish I did know. And there are things like they just have to sort of they have to the thing that sets it off is you have to start production.
You
right?
have to be in pre-pro by a certain point, okay. And then you have to be in like active production, which is why the Daredevil rights reverted back because they were in pre-production, but they never got to production in time, and it's weird.
Yeah, it's something that we don't quite know the answer to, I don't think. But I think that I don't see Fox making another Fantastic Four movie.
If I was Fox, I wouldn't.
I mean,
I'd sell it back. And I would ask for money.
I wouldn't let it run out. I would make some kind of deal.
Yeah, like what Sony did, because Sony has a share deal now.
Right, exactly. Which works, hopefully, well. We'll find out soon enough.
I think it
will. Homecoming is looking good, looking tasty. All right, Commander Parsons, CM Parsons asks, over or under 50%, will Ben give up on his Batman character in the DC universe because of interference with other projects?
All the projects that he's put out since he was signed as Batman are Warner Brothers projects, so I would doubt it.
Yeah, I mean, he's pretty much a staple now. All his four movies, you've got Gone Baby Gone, you've got The Town, you've got Argo, which won Best Picture, and now Live by Night. I mean, people are saying that Live by Night might not be up to snuff, but I haven't seen it yet, but it's a period piece. It looks gorgeous. Robbie Richardson shot it. I don't think Warner Brothers is a studio that has long-standing relationships with directors.
Yeah.
They're not keen to get somebody, a filmmaker of great talent. They're not keen to let them go.
Even he was in The Accountant, which he didn't direct. Gavin O'Connell directed, but that was still a Warner Brothers production. So I think it's pretty clear just from that that they're going to keep him in-house, which means that he can do whatever he wants with the schedule of Warner Brothers Pictures.
Yeah.
I would say, yeah. I would be very surprised if he walks away from the Batman role at this point without some insane thing happening.
Yeah.
Because that, you know, and he's a smart dude and he's a grown up and he, like, he made this decision to be Batman and it, you know, whatever it takes between him and making that movie happen, even if, and I don't want this to happen, even if he ends up being happier with somebody else taking the directing reins and him just doing writing or acting, like, I feel that movie's going to happen. We're going to see it.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, everyone loved Ben Affleck as Batman.
He's a great Batman.
He's a good Batman.
Regardless of what you think about BVS, like, he was great in that role.
Yeah.
And what he had to put up with when he was first announced. I mean, let's remember. Let's remember, Internet.
Look, I was on that train too. I was not enthused by that choice. But when you step back and you look at the pedigree and then you look at the performance, don't be like that.
Yeah, no. I mean, it's interesting. We've gone through it a lot. Heath Ledger's the Joker. Well, oh
even
my God.
Michael Keaton is Batman.
No, we've seen it over and over again. Hugh Jackman doesn't look like Wolverine, does he? He's 6'2".
He's
so tall. He's a song
and
dance man.
People are still mad that he's tall. It's been like 15 years, and there are still people who are just like, but that's not Wolverine.
They just want him to walk out singing Oklahoma.
Yeah, he's also human beings are not for color. Either. They're more colors than that. They have subsurface scattering in their skin. That's how they made Gollum in Lord of the Rings. They learned how to do subsurface scattering. That's why it looks real. All right. John Sava asks, will we see Adam Warlock in the MCU, and will the Abomination and the Red Skull come back? Boy, that's, I mean, they did bring back.
Did we say earlier that we don't work for Marvel?
I know.
I think if Red Skull's coming back, it's not Hugo Weaving, because he has said unequivocally that he will not return to that role. Those are all great characters to see again, so why not?
What I'd say for, sorry, you were talking.
Oh, that's it.
I would expect it's very unlikely that we see Red Skull again unless we do end up with somebody else picking up the cap shield. And in which case, it would almost be weird if we didn't eventually get it. Like, there is a level of, if the movies behave like the comics, eventually we have to see Red Skull again in some fashion. Even if it's maybe, like, maybe we won't see Red Skull, but we'll get Sin, daughter of Red Skull, and she'll
That'd
cause
be
trouble.
Cool.
It is, I don't know, Abomination, unless they start doing solo Hulk movies again, I don't know if we'll see Abomination. Adam Warlock seems like a good bet, though.
He'd be great in the Guardians of the Galaxy of it all.
Yeah, the cosmic side of the universe. Mm-hmm.
Or, I mean, if they're, you know, with all the other cosmic characters that they're introducing, who knows?
You could see all of these people in Thor Ragnarok when we're all on, not Battle World, but when we're all fighting in the arena together.
Right, although I really want to hear Hugo Weaving say, bring forth the Tesseract.
If you back up enough money to his house, he'll say it.
Yeah, it would be good. I mean, I don't know. I think, look, who knows? They brought back William Hurt for Civil War from Incredible Hulk. I never thought I'd see that. And Betty Ross is coming back.
Supposedly.
I mean, Liv Tyler is going to be back. And she knows Hugo Weaving.
He was her dad.
So, you know, who knows? Who knows? Well, that brings us, Birds of Prey, to the sweaty question of the week. David Nerfherder 21 asks, do you think the person who got his spine broken in Doctor Strange was the Vulture teasing an end of Homecoming? Ooh.
Maybe?
I think they said the person was like a 34-year-old Marine.
Yes, the person is quite a bit younger than we know Michael Keaton to be, who's playing the Vulture in Homecoming.
Although it was a thing that I hadn't thought about that would be super cool if they had dropped a Spider-Man Homecoming reference into that. I don't know. Does anyone have a more updated fan theory than the one that I think we talked about shortly after the movie came out? That it sounded as if they said Marine in their 30s.
I thought it was Rhodey.
Wrong. And then the next theory that people proposed when I think Derrickson had said it wasn't Rhodey. I think the next theory that people had was that it was one of the people testing armor for Justin Hammer in Iron Man 2.
Well, that's interesting. But do we even know if Homecoming is crossing over with Doctor Strange? I mean, we know Doctor Strange is all up in Thor, and there's rumors that he's part of like a whole episode act. But
I would be surprised. We haven't heard anything about Doctor Strange showing up in Homecoming.
But we know Tony's obviously Tony's a big part of that.
And the timeline in Doctor Strange is, let's face it, all over the place.
But it can be whatever you want. It's like Doctor Who.
It is. That is true. That is true. It is
but
like
if the
Doctor
earlier
Who.
Event is pegged to Iron Man 2, then that does give you some amount of time for the injury and recuperation and training
and all that stuff.
But
not 20 years.
Yeah. Well,
I mean, I do like the idea.
20 years, sadly.
Maybe it's a really rough like 3 or 4 years.
Yeah.
Well, I do think it's cool, though. I mean, I think it is kind of neat to think Doctor Strange, Stephen Strange, fixed Rhodey.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I like that idea. You know, everybody kind of hopes everyone else.
Rather refused to, because he was just like, someone else can do it.
Oh, that's
right?
True.
Wasn't that the one that he said, like...
Dr. Nick does it. Yeah, because that's right before he crashes his car, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because he's like, show
me
something more interesting.
Before he stops on whoever the lady with the plate is.
Well, screw you, Doctor Strange.
Yeah, right?
Well, maybe that's what Thor was going to talk to Stephen Strange about. Really, he said, "Look, you need to help out one of my friends who's got a broken back or something."
10 out of 10, I would love that.
You know, that would be fun. Well, this brings an end to my first and perhaps last time ever hosting a show here on Collider. I want
to
thank you all for watching, and I want to thank my lovely co-hosts or we're guests. We're all guests.
We're all guests. Yes, running the asylum.
You're either a guest in life or a host. Be a host. But guests, where can they find you, Ashley Robinson?
You can find me on Twitter and Instagram at Ashley B. Robinson. And starting tomorrow, Jason Inman and I are running a Kickstarter campaign for our Action Lab miniseries, Jupiter Jets, about a 16-year-old girl with a jetpack who wants to save the world with a sci-fi twist. You can find it at jupiterjetcomic.com. Please. Like it, share it, donate. Every dollar helps.
Did you show me concept art for this a while ago?
I did.
And it was amazing, and I was like, when is this a thing? Make this a thing, internet.
Who's
up
drawing
for this.
It?
Ben Matsuya is drawing it, Mara Jane is coloring it, and Taylor Esposito is lettering it.
Wow, that's very exciting.
Thank you.
Amy, where can people find you?
You can find me at EnthusiAmy all over the internet, or all over Geek and Sundry, or showing up for Ashley's Kickstarter.
Yay!
I'm just so excited.
Am I going to get in trouble with like Will Wheaton and his posse for making fun of playing video games? I mean, playing board
games.
Amy's
going
to
send them after you.
Right, only you can judge you.
I just want to say I apologize to anybody who really likes playing board games or watching people play board games on the internet. I do actually.
I'm going to pull a community. I roll to pity you.
Oh.
I roll to pity you for not understanding the joy.
I do understand the joy. As long as people are playing Risk, my favorite board game of all time.
What about Risk
Multiple
Legacy?
Multiple World.
I
love Risk. All Risk.
Yet.
Any Risk.
Sorry, the whole trend of legacy game versions of board games where you turn them into giant RPG campaigns is amazing, and I haven't gotten to do one yet, and I'm just hijacking this ending.
But you know, Heather Navarro's right. I probably am old and crusty because I have no idea what you just said.
Oh, you're going to love it.
It sounds great, though.
As soon as we get off the air.
Well, listen, that brings an end to this episode, this John Schnepp-less episode. I know he's out there in the Yukon being Sasquatch to the rest of Alpha Flight, but let's hope John comes back real soon because it's hard to do this job. So that brings an end to Collider Heroes episode number 92. Stay sweaty, everyone, and come back next week.
Hey guys, if you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.